So we're trying out the circle concept tonight. Okay, well, you know, I accepted my invitation at 69. Awesome, guys. So welcome, everybody. For anyone that doesn't know me, my name's Ben Nash. I'm one of the co-founders of XY Advisor and a financial advisor as well. My business is just up the street here. We're really excited for Silicon Valley on the bridge. Silicon? What is it? You're the fintech guy.
Mate, however, but...
Don't chastise me, then. Yeah, firstly, I just want to say a big thank you to the IOOF guys for their support tonight. Can the IOOF guys just stand up for a second? MG? The rest of the team? They are. Thank you, IOOF. If anyone doesn't know these guys, have a chat. I'm a little biased. MG's my favourite, but they're all really good guys, so have a chat to them, and thanks very much for your support. You know, when I was talking to Clay about when we were preparing for this event, he was talking about this venture capital business and saying, like, who cares about that? Like, why is that important for us? And it took him a while, but he was talking about these changes to equity crowdfunding. And, you know, I think anybody knows from when they're working with their clients that it's a very interesting space, and a lot of people are excited by this. I think that as advisors, our clients are quite interested in learning more, and you know, the sexy side of venture capital and startup investing. With the recent changes to the crowdfunding laws, which we're going to hear more about tonight, I think we're going to be getting more and more questions about this. So the idea of the session tonight is just to help everyone understand how they can have informed conversations with their clients. So yeah, really excited to bring this to you. First event in Stone and Chalk. First event with a circle pit as well, which is, I think, pretty awesome. So we hope you guys enjoy it. A bit of housekeeping, guys. Bathroom's at the back, if you don't know. The bathroom's just over there. The bar is there. Don't go to the bathroom. The bar, that'll be weird. Food over there as well. A couple of updates from XY Advisor. We've been real busy in recent times working on a bunch of new things. When we do events like this, we get a lot of feedback that people really love the networking time, and they don't want us to have too much content because they want time to catch up and, you know, make friends and catch up with old friends, and they want the networking side of things. But we've also had a bunch of feedback about people that want more content. So early next year, at the start of February, we're going to be launching a membership where we're bringing some of the best content from the community out to whoever wants it, basically, in the form of short courses that are going to help people solve problems in their business. So we've got legends such as Peter Diamond Tees, delivering short courses, as well as a bunch of other people that have got some great ideas and really getting that message out. So we're super excited about that. Keep an eye out for that early in the new year. And we've got a bunch of other cool things planned for 2018, which you'll hear more about when the time comes. So, without further ado, I just want to introduce Peter, who's going to be the MC for the event tonight. Peter Diamantidis, her business, Caboodle Financial Services. If you've been hiding under a rock and don't know her, she's won pretty much all the awards out there. She is a perfect person to push these guys tonight, because she's been on both sides of the table when it comes to investment banking and venture capital. Previous to being a financial advisor, Peter worked in an investment bank on venture capital for a range of different projects, mostly very big projects. and in her own business has also raised capital to support the business projects that she works on as well. So yeah, I'll turn it over to Peter, and we hope you enjoy the night.
Thank you. Welcome everybody. Yeah. My first job here tonight is to welcome you all. There are a couple of seats for those at the back. There's a seat there, and please don't be shy to sit behind us if you want to be comfortable. We promise you a great job on you if you're not off. It's okay. But why don't I start with introductions? First off, Ben Heath. Am I saying your surname right? With the worst surname here, I understand. Ben's a founding partner at H2 Ventures, and you guys are based here in the building here. And he works alongside fintech startups, you know, providing investment but also business acumen and support and development and growth to make sure they're a success. But he also happens to have a background in investment banking with UBS like me, and so we're hoping you won't hold that against us. We are previous investment bankers. Welcome, Ben. Next up we have, we have Joel DeRory. Joel's joining us as a co-founder and CEO at Nord. Not North, which was what I first read when I saw it. apologies, Joel. Joel's, and Nod has built a platform, really interesting actually, to transform the way advisors and the public connect by providing online, on-demand solutions or answers to questions that the public might have, am I describing that appropriately? Both advisors and accountants, so you have experts on that platform that can then respond to people's questions.
Not quite, I know.
Yeah, do you do it?
Yeah. So,
So we were a marketplace platform for financial advice. We've recently pivoted, but we now, so one of the core parts of that marketplace was we built an artificial intelligence service which wrote statement of advice documents for advisors in real time. So it learns from your historical corpus of statement of advice documents, learns how you like to write, learns where everything goes, and then can kind of produce it in response to a new fact find. So if you go to nod.money, you'll see that demo. That's kind of cool. But we've kind of got our first couple of customers on that now. So we've kind of left the marketplace behind a little bit, and we're now selling our platform to advisors.
Interesting, because that leads in one of the first questions I had. Well, I'll come back. So last but not least, we have Clayton Daniel, who was an original member of the XY Advisor boy band. he's actually here today.
Turn Harry Potter.
He's actually here today as a founder of Sprout Super. It's not quite wrong either. Sprout Super, which is a new super platform and basically designed to help investors get access to early stage ventures, which they currently can't do on normal super platforms. Did I get that right? Is that fair?
Yeah.
All right. So let's set the scene. First of all, XY has sort of been founded on being open, sharing the realities and the difficulties in business. And so I guess I wanted to say to each of you, please be brutal and be honest and be happy to disagree with each other and me. Fight club rules. So I'm hoping that we can sort of really get some insights that aren't quite as conditioned as I think we sometimes get about new ventures and particularly VC. To relax us a bit first, I've got some very difficult questions for you. Ben, barbecue sauce or tomato sauce?
Tomato.
I'll forgive you for that. All right. Joel, Aussie rules or rugby union?
I grew up playing Aussie rules, so Aussie rules.
Really? So with the Uni New South Wales, is that the team that you were involved with? And you had some big wins in here this year. Did the girls have a...
They did.
Ah, nice. Very good. Girls kicking ass. We'd like to see that. Final important question. Clayton, Star Wars or Star Trek?
Harry Potter.
I'm gonna go.
No, neither.
You are now dead to me forever. All right. Now that they've relaxed into their chairs, I thought we might start with hype. There's a lot of hype around fintech. Whether you're an advisor, whether you're in VC, whether you're a bank, or you're the public, there's a lot of hype. But I'm sort of wondering whether actually hype around marketable ideas can actually cause some of the more transformative and less sexy ideas to get pushed aside. And so I guess I wanted to start, Joel, with you, because in fact, when I understood you were out of the public, but I heard you were using AI for things like statement advice, my question was going to be, why the hell aren't you using that tech to get advisors better at statements of advice? So actually that's, which is less sexy, right? I mean, it's easier to sell something that's pitching to the public than it is to pitching to advisors.
Definitely.
Yeah, I don't know if that's quite accurate, but sure. So we, you know, we kind of launched the marketplace platform, got into it, and started talking to both sides, so advisors and the public. But as we went on, we worked out that if we didn't solve some of these problems for the advisor community, we wouldn't ever solve the problem for the public, because the process was fundamentally broken. You couldn't give advice in less than 4 weeks. So with that in mind, we kind of just listened to what both sides were saying and picked the problem that we needed to solve first, the most important problem. And I'm sure if I polled the room, the worst part of an advisor's day is kind of living in X-ray and coin and these sorts of places and writing statements of advice document. So we were always planning on solving that problem for the marketplace, and now we're solving that problem for a living. Yeah.
And you would say a lot of just coming through, not just the ones you end up involved in. Do you see that there's the danger of the sexy getting attention over the potentially more almost engineering and dull and a bit dry?
Yeah, so, no, I guess I wouldn't characterise it that way. I think there's a lot of hype around fintech, there's a lot of hype around sort of technology. It's utterly justified. Now, that doesn't mean it's not quietly and bubbly, and that doesn't mean there's not going to be things that kind of fall over and die, but the reason there is hope so much hype around this space is because we're in the early stages of what's going to be a really fundamental reshaping of financial services, and financial services is much broader than just one sector of the economy. It's actually kind of the wheels of the economy. It's the grease that makes the economy move. And if you look at what's going on in terms of businesses like all the marketplace businesses, a lot of the payments businesses, the blockchain is one of those classically kind of hype terms, but it's going to be pretty significant over the next decade or so. These things will really fundamentally reshape the way a lot of business activity goes on. So the advantage of the hype and is you're getting a lot of a lot of smart people coming into this space, a lot of energetic people, a lot of ambitious people. The vast majority of those ideas won't work. But innovation is a sort of a combinatory thing. So it's very rare someone just comes up with a really terrific idea and that changes the world. It's much more likely, I'll use my favourite example, which is Google. The founders of Google didn't invent search engines. In fact, they were very likely to that. But they kind of worked out, actually, we could just get a little bit clever about how we search. And took what was quite an emerged idea, which was search, and turned it into the biggest company in the world.
Clayton, for your future investors in Super, and I mean actually the customers, it's about Super, then how do you face that challenge? How do you tap them into great opportunities and potentially miss a few more of what Ben's saying here, which is the ones they're just undoubtedly going to find?
Yes, so following on from Ben, most won't work. So our goal is not to create a venture capital firm. Thank God. I'm not jealous at all. So what we'll be doing is off the back end of what else is being happening in the market, so using deal flow from other VC firms, because it's such a small amount that are actually high quality. Something I've been learning a lot about lately is in our industry, venture capital, or private equity as it's known as an asset allocation, to us has been really looked down upon because 10 years ago a bunch of super funds threw a lot of money into a bunch of firms that didn't really end up with great results. And that's improved a lot over the last 10 years. So our ecosystem and those that are in charge of it are making much better decisions now than they were 10 years ago. So we're riding on the back of that, and we have a bunch of highly experienced that give it that final P's and Q's, then it comes on. It may be as little as one a quarter. Some of the best firms make one investment for 9 months. It's one of those things where it's quality over quantity. And our industry was very much damaged, I think, about 10 years ago from this asset allocation, which thankfully has improved a lot.
Thanks, Clayton. And I should have said, thank you, I should have said before, if you have any questions as we go, just wave your arms madly, do a dance, whatever you need to get my attention, and we'll ask them as you go, but we'll also have Q&A at the end. And feel free to stand up, get food, and get another drink. Please don't feel like you stuck to that chair. We're all being relaxed, so don't be shy. Thinking about another buzzword, another word that's used a lot, is big data and AI, and how you were talking about AI and what you guys are doing. Something that I find interesting in that space, Ben, is a lot of the big data being collected is sort of outcomes-based, meaning it's, you know, financial data. So it's the way that somebody's spending, it's what they're doing in their credit card, that sort of thing, in terms of the public. What I'm curious about is whether you're seeing anything that's more early behavioural, so we can actually see things that are the way people are thinking and what drives them as opposed to the outcome, whether anybody's starting to collect that or try and build that, and whether you're seeing any tools or services that then utilise that to give a better and a deeper service to the customers.
So I would characterise big data as, and another way to talk about it perhaps is raw data, is just there's lots and lots and lots of data about all of us out there now. Truth go looking a frightening amount of data. And in itself, utterly irrelevant. It's just it's raw data. What you're talking about, I think, Peter, is then, you know, your ability to find insights in that data. And so artificial intelligence or machine learning or sort of AI is where computers or the computers programmed by us are able then to identify and eventually self-learn to find patterns in that data. And the sort of patterns they find, I've always found the best example is Amazon. So you jump on Amazon, you buy a book, you buy a couple of books, and then it starts showing you, hey, here's some other books you might like. And you look at them and go, that's exactly what I like. I invariably end up buying four of the five they offer at the bottom of the page. And that's because, at a pretty basic level, they're saying, well, listen, other people who bought the three or four books you've bought tend to then buy this book. So we figure you're likely to like it as well. And there's actually, there is absolutely data in that information when you kind of go search for that data and it becomes quite valuable. So my sense of it is that what we're talking about when we talk about AI is taking all of the data that's been out in the world for a little while now and working out how to utilise that data to be able to create more information.
Do you think that there's gaps? I guess that's where I'm coming from, is it feels like some of the data we're all relying on is that, you know, like it's the late stage data. And maybe it's just because we're not collecting it. Maybe it exists there and nobody's actually bothered to dig that deep. But it feels like there's some early stuff that could give us some earlier trends that instead of reacting, we can almost be more proactive, which is where I think some of the magic can happen in AI. There's some value here. In terms of, Clayton, I'll just jump to you before Joel. Was Sprout sort of a response to that deeper behavioural thing where millennials in particular want to be part of something that's bigging, you know, where they want to take part in it, almost, I use this loosely, Kickstarter style, like they want to be part of something that grows. Is that what Sprout's responding to?
It's actually the result of seeing what good financial advice does. So as a financial advisor, our clients end up with better financial results simply because we help the person connect to their money. And it's the best formula so far, except for, you know, that sort of echelon of people that are very rational and are happy to sort of go in and rebalance their own portfolio on a quarterly basis, right? So if we remove that segment of society, your large mass isn't interested in their money, and that's where financial planners have earned their trade. So we have personified engagement. As someone can look and have a relationship with a person, and they can say, righto, I really like you, and you tell me what to do well with my money, therefore I'll do it, and therefore they end up with better results. When I was writing my book, I did a lot of research around what are some of the most engaging styles of investing. And crowdfunding kept coming to the top. And crowdfunding is a remarkably non-diligent style of investment because you receive nothing. Perhaps you receive the item that you've put an order in for, hopefully.
Otherwise, you receive nothing. But the diligent version of that was angel investing. And so that's the strategy, the productized strategy of engagement, which ultimately is just on the back end of how to engage, which is ultimately where you can layer on education and then better results.
Sort of following on that, in terms of engagement, John, what would you say to advisors? I mean, historically, and even now, there's all these professional standards coming up, so we're all going to have to get more and more degrees and more educated. And I'm super excited, I have to say. But would you say that if we're leaning more towards a world of engagement and almost behavioural coaching style, that advisors need to be learning some different skills, maybe be doing things quite differently than just focusing on the very stuff that your clever AI machine can automate and use formulas for?
I would say exactly that, and so I've always just said yes to that. I'll kind of comment more broadly on maybe a little bit about robot advice and where it fits in the scheme, because we are politely anti-robo, if that makes sense. So we think it's got a place for a certain consumer. I don't actually think it's ever going to be a mainstream thing, personally. I think the reason for that is it's incredibly hard to code for empathy. It's almost impossible. There's so many data points flying around at that particular moment in time that it's incredibly hard to replicate that in a line of code. I think what is important is you automate all the bits around an advice interaction that are not fundamentally necessary to making that client feel better about their financial situation. That's what I think is important. And that's where the kind of behavioural kind of coaching and the kind of counselling mentality is actually the perfect way to describe what needs to happen. And then find ways to make all the other stuff happen at robo speed, so you can make sure we don't lose too many people to that robo advice option.
Cool. I sort of want to get into the nerdy investment banking space for a second with you, Ben. I don't look old enough, I know, but I was in investment banking when the tech bubble happened. I was in infrastructure though, so we were buying and selling trains and things like that. So we were in the uncool division of the bank at that point. But what happened then, of course, was, you know, these businesses were going for huge multiples. They were being listed at huge multiples. But when you took a look under the hood, not only did they not have any cash flow now, they didn't look like they could ever have any cash flow. And of course, then the bubble burst, and within a year or two, more than half of the businesses that floated in that tech space didn't exist anymore. And the thing I guess I wanted to sort of hear from you is there's a couple of similarities. Now, I'm imagining you're going to tell me it's quite different to back then, but some of the similarities are they are offering free or very discounted subscription models to people who build a database. They're using advertising to build market share. It's go big fast. I mean, those are a lot of things that were very consistent back then. So I'm interested in your take on what is different, you know, now to back then, and do you think businesses are doing differently to ensure that they're more successful and they don't, you know, collapse?
It's not so different, it's kind of the same. back then, Google was good. And so while there were 400 or 500, dodgy businesses that ultimately you probably shouldn't have been in, certainly shouldn't have been in, there were a few that if you were so lucky to be in, you would never be worrying about money again. And they were businesses that most certainly built very big, very profitable businesses in the world. And I think that's exactly what's happened to us. I think there is any number of businesses which aren't going to really work at a pretty speculative and don't have a lot behind them, but I think there's a couple hidden away in there which are going to build really game-changing business.
And if we all promise it stays in this room, what are some of the things you look for? And I'm not talking about specific to the industry, but what are some of the things you look for to find those gems?
That's a $64 million question. So, but firstly for us, we very much focus on people. At the end of the day, we see a bunch of ideas. We rarely see a new idea. We've seen hundreds of robo-advice ideas, and we've seen a number of leading ideas and so on. But that doesn't a tall mean we won't back the next one. It just means we're looking for the team that we think has the capability to deliver on that. And that ability to execute applies in early stage startup venture capital businesses equally as it does in really, you know, really, really big companies. It's just very, very transparent in startup businesses.
And just give us, John, give us some insight, because most of the people in this room aren't in a startup, and certainly aren't in the world like we're in now at Stone Chalk. I saw a quote the other day that said, being an entrepreneur is a walk in the park, Jurassic Park. Is it how it feels when you're trying to balance building a great idea with just keeping the lights on? You know, how does that feel being a part of something when you're in development mode? As advisors, I mean, that's just not how our businesses normally operate. So how does that feel to be trying to build something while also just keeping the wheels running?
So I think the difference between the corporate world and startup world is that you have the same kind of highs and lows. Like as advisors, I'm sure you have good days and bad days, as we all do at work. But I think in startup land, the highs and lows are probably further apart. It's probably the best way to think about it. So the troughs are far more depressing, but the highs are completely and utterly euphoric. So that's probably how the best way to describe it. I'm yet to see a dinosaur, going and pitching to a VC is not as scary as everyone would assume that it is. Generally, you're there to talk about a really cool idea, so everyone can kind of get around that and engage with that, so that's fine. I think the biggest difference in the characteristics are just the highs and lows are probably a little bit further apart than startup land. It's never boring. Never, ever boring. No.
So Clayton, you've been in both places, right? So you've had an advanced practice, you've been an advisor, and now you're basically in the startup mode yourself. What are the differences you're seeing?
You know, I think you nailed it. It's in advisor land, it's very similar. Good days, bad days, especially when starting your own business. The only difference is, yeah, those euphoric v depressment moments. You know, I just sent an email this afternoon, and so much can come off the back of that. That one email, and someone came in and asked me about seating arrangements as I was writing that email. I sort of just looked at them, and as they were talking to me, I said, I just have to finish this email. And it's crazy how singular moments can be so pivotal. In hindsight, and they're not, but in the moment, I guess the only thing that would be equivalent to is, you know, when you have like a really good prospect and say that they've got $2 million in the bank, and then you're writing that follow-up email to say, you know, do you want to be a client? It's sort of that, just unfortunately more regular.
And Ben, would you say that, I mean, one of the things you're looking for is people that can sort of traverse that, because it is an emotional grind?
Yeah, a big time. We constantly meet people who say they want to be entrepreneurs and believe they do, but we, you know, try to, best we can, to kind of talk them out of it politely, because they're just not cut out for it. I don't say that in any way negatively. It's, you know, it's not for everyone. It's not necessarily the same thing to do either, by the way.
I'm still not sure it's for anyone.
But the differences I see is a scalability to it. So the email you send, or the call you have, or the decision you make, very sliding door kind of moments. The decision you make, maybe the decision that at tenfold your business. And we invest in businesses which we would like to think are going to go up 1,000-fold. That's sort of the target, and sounds sort of silly, but when we invest, they're worth, let's say, $1 million, and we want them to be a $1 billion business. There's not a lot of point in chasing a business that might be 5 times as big, because we know we're going to have lots that don't work.
Yeah.
So you might as well make sure the ones you're chasing that will work are going to be really, really big, and that means it really sort of gives you a clarity about what you're trying to do.
Thank you. I want to sort of get you guys to put yourself in the shoes of the audience here. So as advisors, you know, we're all going to see more and more apps and widgets and tools and businesses and ideas and processes. And in fact, the fresh faces here have 40 years of that, folks. Those of us a bit older, not quite so long. But, you know, these just keep on getting thrown in front of us. And I guess what I'm looking for is tips or tricks to help us assess what we chase. Because, and when I'm talking about chasing, I mean not even necessarily for our clients to invest in, I just mean as what do we fold into our businesses? Because there's only, you know, hundreds of them a day. How do these people here get excited about the right opportunity as it comes up so that they're not chasing their tail and constantly getting excited about the next widget or the next process? John, want to start with you?
Yeah. I think it's a really simple lens. I think you chase things and widgets that you can see clearly are going to fundamentally make your day 10 times better. That's the only lens I would have on that. That's the only tech I would ever buy. If it's not going to do that, then you know, it's a nice to have.
And how about longevity? Because, I mean, that's the other challenge we have is I'm sure we all got excited about something historically that was going to change our business and then they're gone in 12 months and you've invested a lot of time and energy training staff and implementing it and convincing people to do it. Is there any tips you would have on a test for that? Is there something we should be looking for? Is there some way we can get a sense of how long we watch and stalk and when do we jump?
Yeah, so I think you can kind of know what's going on there by the degree of impact it has, because it has a tenfold degree of impact. It's going to take a long time before something else comes in to have another 10. That makes sense. You might have something else that comes in and makes it 1 times better, sure, or 1.5 times better, but it's going to take a long time for something else to come along to disrupt it that much. So that's another lens you can have on that around longevity. I think a good example, I won't use my own thing, but we'll go back later. but I think a really good example for me is DocuSign. So is anyone using DocuSign already? As a salesperson, and I was an enterprise salesperson before I was a startup founder, that was the best app I have ever used by a country mile, because it just meant I could get stuff signed without having to chase it. And it made my day 10 times better. So, and it's going to take a long time before something really changes the electronic signature. DocuSign might become a fingerprint maybe, but it'll be DocuSign that probably does that, not no one else.
I'll pick up on the 10 times point that Joel's made, and which is exactly right. So I agree, it's actually not as hard as you first think. If you have someone who comes in and they pitch something to you or show you a new offer, someone introduces it to you, and yeah, it's a little bit better, 50%, but don't chase that. You don't have the time in your day to chase that. It's look for something that's just easy to decide, because as you say, 10 times better. Now those ones don't come across, your point, Peter's, you know, hundreds a week. The 10 times better ones come along much less frequently. They come along every 3 months or 6 months or 12 months. But they're the ones that are going to succeed. It's the beautiful thing, I think, about being a startup founder, and where it's not quite as hard as
I'm making
that to me. Well, I'm making that to be very hard for obvious reasons. Why I'm good. But the reason it's not really that hard is if you simply focus on things that are going to really fundamentally change. So if you're a startup founder, turn around the other way. If you're a startup founder and your idea is 2 times better, you're actually not going to succeed. Because particularly in financial services, I'll just keep using my, you know, insert big bank name here, wealth product, or my, you know, insert insurer name here, insurance product, because I kind of trust them and I don't really like them, but I trust them, and so that'll do. If, on the other hand, this brand new brand comes along and it's 10 times better, it's no longer a choice. Obviously, I have to use it. Lord's too polite to say, Joel's too polite to say, but not as long
as.
Thanks,
Peter. Yes. I love that you say, yeah, something has to be so much better that people are going to get on board. But isn't there also the second part of someone has to be willing to pay for it? Someone has to be willing to say, I love that so much that I'm willing to contribute to that. Because it can be the best idea in the world and it can fall over. And, you know, the famous, like, previous tech things, like, you know, VCR versus Betamax. And, like, Betamax was better, but... people, you know, so it doesn't necessarily have to be the best idea. It has to be that people are willing to pay for it.
Yeah, so Betamax versus VHS, good example, because Betamax was better, and anyone who was an absolute expert in the field would tell you that. But anyone who's a consumer, not much to say. That was fine as far
as... Can I interrupt you? I'm sorry. This
is very interesting.
What's Betamax? Can you raise your hand if you don't know what Betamax is? Seriously?
To be fair, that's half the room.
That's actually half the room.
I'm going to explain. So, VHS, do you know what VHS... Okay, Betamax was a direct competitor that came out, and so you'd go to the video store and there'd be two sizes of things you could use. So it'd be like if you had CDs this big and CDs this big.
Well, it's like HD, DVD versus Blu-ray.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Just to be clear, soon enough, you will all be in the place that we are in. And you'll go through this too.
And we'll laugh.
It's called MySpace.
I wanted to I think partly it's accidental, but partly intentional. There's a lot of customer-facing money apps that are ignoring the role of advisors, accountants, money coach, anybody that might be a party with that person. How do we as advisors get the word to them to make us part of their development process? Or is it just something we're going to have to accept that they just don't want a part of advising or generally coaches being a part of that? How do we change that? Is it an education? What do we do? Because I have to admit, I'm frustrated because I want to use all of these. My client base is small clients. And some of that's great, but it's difficult for me to do it in partnership with my clients.
So I'll explain it this way. So we like to talk about this idea that fintech's new and it's just appeared and how much the world has changed. But as you would all appreciate, actually, I've just proved that many of you wouldn't appreciate, but for decades and centuries, financial services has been where any amount of technology has been developed and used. And technology has underpinned, notwithstanding Charles disparaging comments earlier, things like sort of X-Plan and the like were absolutely enormous technology breakthroughs. It's just that was sort of 20 years ago now. And so what's happened, the reason fintech has appeared to arise, in my view, is because it's sort of exploded in front of the consumer. Traditionally, technology within financial services was actually behind the scenes. It was a B2B kind of technology. And as consumers, we never really saw it. Why has it exploded? I think the reason for that is because we've reached a point in the evolution of the internet where we as consumers are willing to fundamentally trust the internet. Now again, go back to where you and I were young. There's no way you would trust the internet.
I remember when ATMs were trusted.
Is that like Bitcoin?
So one of the things that fintech is a bit about, or at least the hype of fintech is about, is this idea of consumer-facing product. As a financial advisor, were that my industry, I would have no concern with this idea that financial advisors will be put out of business by robo-advice. So I don't see that for a nanosecond. But I the same sort of advice I sometimes give people in a different context is it's all about looking for where you really add value versus where, you know, frankly, you don't enjoy it. And ironically, that's sort of how it works. The stuff that will get replaced, the administrative role of filling out the size, et cetera, that's the stuff that, unless I'm mistaken, most of you don't particularly enjoy doing. The stuff you enjoy a lot more, which is actually engaging with the customer and understanding the sort of a quirk where actually their particular financial circumstances are kind of driven by the fact that they,
you know, they really love their grandmother but hate their firstborn son kind of thing. And so you need to sort of take that into consideration. That impacts any amount of things. That's something that robo advice isn't going to solve. And it's something that at least for a very long time, AI isn't going to solve it.
I guess I was hanging on the path of something like Penny. I don't know whether you've seen the Penny app. Yeah, and so this is an app where it's a data feed from your bank accounts, but Penny talks to you and SMSs you during the day, letting you know you spent more on lunch, or and chats like it's a friend. And I met these two young guys, and it's the typical, you know, sort of college students working out in their garage story. And they said, Penny, we knew it was working when people said goodnight to Penny at the end of the day. And I guess for me as an advisor, I selfishly want to be able to utilise Penny in my engagement with my clients. The struggle is almost all of those apps don't have any facility for a third party to play any role, even access. So I'm just wondering if you're seeing that is going to change, or if it's a battle we're just going to have to accept and find other ways to engage with those apps.
My sense is that's likely to change. Because ultimately the financial advisor's role within that relationship has value. Things that don't have value aren't going to change. They're going to get replaced and disappear entirely. And that's, you know, a lot of paperwork and process and so on are going to get replaced, and we'll see them again and be delighted with it. But the role of the advisor coming into that equation is much more interesting. And I actually think, and John sort of alluded to it earlier, that the Nod story is an interesting one in this context, because he started on his journey with very much a focus on that sort of consumer focus. But it sort of became clear that the role the advisor plays actually is really quite valuable, and that's a role that could be significantly and quickly improved in a way that would benefit the consumer. And that sort of flows through. A good example here is Xero. So Xero focuses on consumers, anyone who's ever used Xero. But it's a cool product in that what they sort of struggled a bit at first, and then they worked out, actually, we should be selling to accountants. Accountants will convince all their customers to come on board. And the product, while we as consumers think it's terrific to use on it, as an accountant, it's even better. Because the accountant's one is a handy shoebox of receipts that actually did used to do that. And now the accountant just gets it all in this perfect digital form, and they, you know, immediately analyse it all. They're the sort of products that they want to see.
Now, I'm happy to go to questions, yeah? So do we have some for Ben? Did you want to start with a question?
Yeah, I'll kick it off. I've got a question mainly for Ben, but I'm keen to hear Clay's thoughts on this as well. With the changes to the equity crowdfunding laws and people being able to access venture capital, I think, well, you're obviously, you know, you've been in this space for a long time and you know all the things to look for, but how do you expect people to be able to sift through the things that are, like, to determine what's good and what's not good? Like, what hope do they have? Like, I'm a financial advisor, can rock a spreadsheet, but I have no idea, you know, how to look at that when you look at the potential of the company, because I'm sure you may disagree, but I think you might agree that the numbers probably don't tell the story.
Yeah, so I'll start with the last part of your question, Ben. So we've made 40 investments over the past few years, and we've looked at close to 1,000. Unless I'm mistaken, I don't believe we've looked at a spreadsheet yet as part of that decision-making process. And it's just the nature of when we look at things. I mean, it's kind of a made up spreadsheet, really has no tangible value versus the other things, obviously, we do look at. So with that in mind, I must admit, and speak a little bit against my kind, I'm a little bit nervous about crowdfunding and what sort of crowdfunding means. I think the idea of engagement, which is one of the potential upsides of crowdfunding, the idea of people feeling like they're, you know, they're playing a role, they're involved, they sort of believe in the ecosystem, I think there's some value in that somewhere, but I think the examples of people who are going to make a lot of money by investing through crowdfunding are going to be, you know,
some of the most exciting is also social conscience, right? There's a lot of social conscious ideas.
Yeah.
Crowd funding is perfect for that. Probably wouldn't get funding otherwise.
Correct.
But do, you know, because of the nature of that sort of personality.
Yeah, so my view is, and I'm sure everyone in this room will probably agree, people don't make smart money choices. And so to your point, yeah, I actually 100% agree with you. But the facts are, as an advisor, I would still have clients come to me and say, I'm going to invest in this startup. What do I do? Send me the spreadsheet. I was blown away with how excited people were, and that repetitive behavior is what we call, you know, behavioral finance, right? So are people? We all wish people were robots. If everyone was a robot, we'd have the best clients in the world. There's absolutely no question. So to your question around how to make good startup investments, I wish that there was a product that did that for you. You might just have to wait a couple of months. shameless.
So I think I might put my startup founder hat on around this issue, because in Australia, there is a real gap between the kind of accelerator programs that Ben and H2 run, which are great for kind of getting you started and getting you to quit your day job and all that sort of stuff. They're great for that. But there is a bit of a gap in Australia anyway between finishing those sorts of programs and going to all that cash and Series A. So there is a gap in Australia around that seed funding piece. So as a startup founder, I look at equity crowdfunding and I'm like, cool. Another kind of pool of investors that I can tap into to get me through that really, it's actually the most dangerous period too, to be honest. Once you've got Series A, you've got a lot of money behind you, a lot of support, a lot of a big team, you're kind of more scaling up. Seed is actually a bit of a valley of death in Australia anyway. So as a startup fan, I'm a bit excited about equity crowdfunding. And for an advisor, the way I would think about this is, if you take off your advisor hat and kind of think about yourselves as founders in your own business and your own kind of client books and all that sort of stuff, we preach and Ben preaches, you've got to listen to your customers, and if your customers are saying you want to engage with this stuff, then you've kind of got a choice. You can either ignore it or you can follow that rabbit hole to see where it leads. Generally, I found that following the customer, or the voice of the customer, worked out better than not.
Yes, I'm really conscious of your time. We're sitting at quarter past.
Yes.
So
I've got a little girl who's in gymnastics, so I'm going to leave in about 3 minutes because we don't want to leave her standing.
We can still have more questions, but we'll just come back.
I didn't know it was a 3 minutes go question. I love the idea that you guys are all solving one problem. But the problem when we are in financial services talking to a client is we have 15 different problems to solve for our client. And so when one of you might introduce a new product or solution, it is only 1/15 of the problem. And so what we face is we want to move from X-Plan to Midwinter to Advisor Logic or something of the like, and none of you guys talk to one another. So what is your solution and view on how tech should talk to one another in the future, and what would you do to build your systems today to know that you're going to lose a client in the future by moving that client into the new tech that you haven't invented yet?
Wait, no, so I'll lead off. So the great strength of startups is they do have a really sort of acute focus. The big difference with big organisations is they obviously concentrate on being able to do all things. What's really interesting about where technology is going is this greater capacity for technology to be able to talk to each other. What's the reality for you as advisors? There's no chance any of that's going to be seamless for the foreseeable future. So that's fine. That's in part the role you're able to play, is to pick and choose. What you're likely to see is this increasing sense of sort of smart platform plays and think Apple, iPhone,
You know, the genius of the Apple iPhone was actually, while an incredibly sort of simple interface, there's an almost limitless range of different apps you can have on that iPhone and how they communicate. And there's going to be that sort of opportunity in the marketplace. A lot of the emergent technology at the moment, a lot of the things that are coming through right now, are solving one thing, and then you'll start to see those come together at the top is my
if I can comment on my business for a second. So we don't see ourselves as, it's an AI that generates statements of advice in real time, we don't see ourselves as a competitive UX plan or to Midwinter or to Advisor Logic. I'd actually love to integrate all those systems. In fact, I asked them to integrate all of them this week. One of the great ways you can help people like us is to put some pressure on those players and ask them to build APIs. But I fundamentally think that they should have that there should be APIs between everything.
Is that Midwinter?
All of them.
Julian, you better be watching. No pressure.
Sure.
Better be. Okay. You better be watching. He's the CEO of Midwinter.
Yeah. Julian Palmer, yeah.
Fundamentally
for people who are coming in trying to solve a particular problem, which for us is just the bit when you do the document generation, all the other platforms are fine for CRM and workflow, well, they're fine, they're great. But this document generation piece has been left behind for whatever reason, we want to just solve that. So for us, we would absolutely love to integrate with those systems. So, and for them, if I'm putting, so Julian's watching, I think he's already kind of done a lot of this stuff, but the smart play for those platforms is to build ecosystems around what they do. The smart play, in my view, is to allow an open API, allow people to build amazing apps that you could never build yourself, given your size and scale, and build great ecosystems around your core platform, which is really good. So that's how I would answer that. APIs for everything, let people kind of solve the problems that you haven't quite got to yet.
And in fact, a lot of the non-fintech apps overseas, the ones that are getting that next level of funding you're talking about, are the ones that do exactly that, that have the ecosystem.
Yep.
You know, they're the ones that succeed. Do we have another question?
Yeah, we've got one over here.
Under suffrage. You have a question.
What's the next big tech startup I should invest in?
Well, this is specifically a recommendation, and I'm not including it in an SOA unless it's built by AI.
He doesn't have a license anymore, so he can give recommendations.
On that point, actually, Nod has a paraplanning role at the moment going. Yes. So if anybody's in that space and interested, I encourage you to talk to Joel. It's probably something quite unusual and different. So
yeah, come and see me after. It's not your standard paraplanning role. Very, very different.
It's an exciting role. Like, if someone's a paraplanner and wants to move into a tech startup, very cool.
It's a question over here.
Hi, guys. I just wanted to know, probably more of a personal question, in that what made you guys transition from, say, into a startup company? What was there something pivotal like that happened that...
Yeah.
Can I just say I love all these things about pivot? I feel like this is an amazing
for me it was just taking what I did as a financial planner, helping people, and then trying to scale it. Ultimately, it's no more complex than that.
But was it frustration?
Yes. Yes, it was frustration. But I love it so much. It's something I don't think I'll ever fully leave. I give unlicensed advice at this stage. No. So I've
got reporters here. Fantastic.
Yeah. It's something that I'll never leave, and I look forward to probably having a company at a later stage again. But it does, as we all know, have its limitations. And so if I can create engagement at scale, I've got to give it a shot.
We have a question.
Hey there. Interesting to hear your thoughts. Thanks for sharing, guys. There's been a couple of very, I think,
pertinent questions around this myriad of apps, tools and software, and I'm starting a company in February and I'm going through the whole process, which I'm sure all of us have done at least once or twice in the last couple of years, of what's the full getup of all the apps that we plug together to make perfect practice. And the XY Advisor site is awesome for that because there's always feeds and questions and threads. I wonder if you or anyone in the room has like started compositing like ideal commutations of all the apps and what works best at this point in time, like the macro of the technology space.
Can I start? So as something of a tech freak in this space, I would argue it's like asking somebody what's the best car. Are you married? Do you have kids? Do you live in the bush? Do you not? How much are you going to be driving in the city? Do you not? So I think there is never the best app even for that particular channel. You know, so even for a particular single thing it does. It's about you knowing your offering so well that one of them stands out for each little step you need to take. So I guess, which I know isn't the answer you wanted, because what you wanted was pivot, here are the top five. But unfortunately, if you don't know your process and your offering well enough, no app is going to fix that. So starting with what you want to do in a manual and awkward and difficult and clunky way, and then finding solutions to make it 10 times better, as John said, that's where I start. Because I think we've all tried to implement stuff because it was really cool and it really sucked when you try to use it, right? And that's because we didn't understand what we were trying to solve. So that's my take.
I actually think the best kind of group of apps is actually to not have an app at all. Like if you can get out from behind the computer screen and just talk to people and customers, I think that's actually the ultimate thing. So I would actually say no app, even though that's what I do. But if you've got to have apps, and most of us do, I would start with the most recent stuff. I would start with stuff that allows you to connect other things to it. So I would start with things that have an API already, so you can build kind of around that and you can connect things up, because that will save you time down the track. And then it's just about kind of what works for you and what you're trying to achieve. But definitely go for things which already have that connectability, because it'll make your business more flexible. Yeah.
And just to follow on from that, I think this tip I got from Peter is go to the Slack website, look at their integrations. Anything they integrate with is probably pretty good. So just like...
That's
so
and I'd follow that. Like, that's not bad.
Yeah.
That's
going to be on this room, that tip. All right. It works. In fact, they're in categories. So you can literally search all the different types and it's a big long list. It's also a black hole though, guys, so that, you know, be careful like you allocate and put like an alarm that says stop looking, because 8 hours later you'll still be looking at the
opportunities. Yeah, I have an Adrian filter. So Adrian, I don't know if everyone knows Adrian, but Adrian, he spends in 90% of his day on tech, and he'll just waste his life for my benefit. Yeah.
Do we have any questions over here?
I got the mic, so I feel like I can have the word. I got a question for Clayton.
Yes.
Just curious to hear.
How are you?
Good, mate. Good. Loved everything which you said about engagement. I think that's absolutely true. Yeah, it's really interesting to see.
Speaking of which, I actually just got engaged.
Yeah. So I'm interested to know, with all of that in mind, trying to do all that engagement at scale.
Yes.
How are you going to balance all the VC side, which I get is pretty much the driver of that?
Yes.
And prudent investing, because the engagement's only good while that person is engaged, but they can be engaged in a very negative sense.
100%. Yeah.
So how are you going to balance that?
Yeah. So again, not building a VC firm. So using deal flow that. So when someone says. When someone like Ben said we saw 1,000 and we invested in 40, we have those partners. And that 40 comes to our panel, and then we have really high quality, as in, you know, X people from some of the top engineers in Australia to just P&Q it. So just run their eyes over it and just say, does this hit our mandate? Right? So first of all, only smart money. And only other sophisticated investors are already on the train, then we throw our own layer over the top.
So it's almost, can it get through a second layer of VC due diligence before it can come onto platform? So in the beginning, it'll be very slow because we've only got a few partners. As we grow and over time, our partners expand, therefore deal flow increases. We still keep that additional secondary layer. I could argue it's probably theoretically the highest level of VC investment possible. Yeah, correct. There are liquidity measures. Yes. So, I mean, I can bore you with the details.
I think I've got a question. So this is for Joel. Love the idea, but the one thing that
Luke.
Yes. Yeah. So I took your app to our dealership, and
met them last week.
Yeah. That's what I was going to ask. Do you find that dealerships are a bit of a roadblock in this kind of thing, or you feel like it's going to be progressive? Because I feel that dealerships, with their compliance, try to justify what they, their existence, and that your kind of app is going to leap above that. So do you see an issue there? Because you want to kind of...
So, good question. So, we often get resistance. Well, no, I wouldn't say often, but obviously there's a little bit of the unknown on what is artificial intelligence, how does it work, how does it produce a document, how does that work with my current process. There's lots of check boxes and drop down menus and stitching all that together, and it takes a few hours and something happens. It's not like the world I'm used to. So you obviously get that kind of fear of the unknown when you first go into a dealer group or but what we've found is that ultimately the economics really talk. So with your dealer group in particular, once the economics are kind of laid out on the table, you have a real-time SOA versus one that takes kind of 8 hours, and that's kind of spread over a few weeks. An SOA that's costing $400 to $1,000 to produce for most firms versus one that's costing less than $20. Once you get to that conversation, it starts, it's tied, and that kind of starts to turn. So the skepticism gives way to, oh, there's a little bit of opportunity here, this sounds at least something that we should look at, and then you kind of get in, you have the opportunity to trial it, so, yeah.
I think something as advisors we've sort of got to accept, and we did when we were in a dealer group, was people in large institutions, and particularly lawyers, fill silence with fear. They're actually trained to do that, right? So they're trained to question and say no. So when you are taking something to them that you know there's going to be a whoop, right, you know it. I mean, you all do, right? You go, this is awesome. The minute you say this is awesome, they're going to go, this can't be good, right? Then I would argue you need to view that you are pitching on behalf of that VC as well as he did when he pitched to get that money. You need to have an answer for everything. You need to understand what drives those lawyers, what drives compliance, what their concerns are, and be already prepped with the answer. So when we've done this with our business, it's quite unusual. We used to have a lot. I was ready for every question they ever had. Because then you get to the bottom of it and it's removed their fear. There's nothing left. So I think we've got to be more proactive and pitch on behalf of these ideas and take that responsibility a bit seriously. I think, and I know I've been guilty of this, is saying, this is really awesome, can you tell me if we can do it? Hashtag fail. There's just no way that's going to happen. So I think we need to sort of own that and push hard. Another question?
Yeah, firstly, thank you for your time today. It's my first XY advisor event that I've attended now. It's really insightful, so.
Welcome.
Thank you. There's a lot of talk and there's a lot of, I suppose, hype around objective-based advice and where does that lead into the market. So for me and my understanding when it comes to objective-based advice and how to help clients achieve perhaps their short, medium, and long-term goals, to reach those goals, I would imagine it has a lot to do with cash flow management and what is out there except for Betterment is there something that's more in the thunder phase than the wonder phase when it comes to cash flow management and helping advisors in that space?
Yeah,
have you been planted?
Yeah, I built my financial planning career around cash flow. So there's a great amount of technology, thankfully these days, and advisors that have killed it far better than I used to. But you're exactly right. So So when someone says, I want to get married in 12 months, which I am, there's not a product for that, right? There's not a product for that. So you have to be able to...
It should be.
It's a diamond ring.
Would you agree, though, that the problem is not being able to measure the cash flow and project the cash flow, and the problem is when people ignore what the spreadsheet is saying and they do stuff anyway?
Yeah, so to properly answer your question, there's a lot of products for cash flow. I guess what I meant was there's no products to manage the emotions that come with ignoring. There's no product to keep people in line. So you're exactly right.
And that's why I think for most of us, we're going to have to learn how to become coaches. We're not going to have a choice.
That's what I'm trying to say. Move away from that spreadsheet environment.
Correct. The numbers aren't the point.
Yeah.
And I would also be back on your point around Penny before, Penny.io. Cool, it's a chatbot. But fundamentally, people are going to ignore Penny. So Penny will, in my view, I don't think it's ever going to have mass engagement. It's never going to be a mass market product. It's not cool, works well. But people are going to ignore it, and because they start to ignore it, they start to disengage with it. That's the problem with robo, in my view, and why advisors, people, will always be informed of this calculation.
If I could just add to that, I think that one of the big things with cash flow-based advice is that people like pay you to tell them to save money, which sounds really like it's like an most important thing. But people can't do it without it, and I think that's why what you talked about with Penny, it does feel like, yeah, okay, I'll say good night to my chatbot, but really, like, she's
how many people
are
you down, though? Come on, man. It's one person who did that.
At least one.
Have we seen the movie She, Her?
I don't think that the behavioural element can be replaced in that, and it's the accountability to a human, because it's like you have a conversation with someone. Yeah.
But I also think it's a skill to the advisor. I'm not a financial advisor, forgive me. But if I was a private financial advisor, I think it's a real skill and be able to put that, you need to save some money in a way that makes me feel good about doing that. And that's, again, really hard for a penny to make work. Easier for
Yeah, motivation, momentum. If you look at how fast personal training is growing in this country, there's more trainers than there are people. I am confident. But why is that working, and why is it growing so fast? Because we know we should eat better and move more. We're not idiots. We need motivation and momentum, and that's what the public need. And we're not giving it to them. I don't think as an industry.
And do we want to ask questions or get a bit?
Well, I got one more question.
Oh, one more question.
Yeah, there's one more over there.
Clean a beer.
Please.
Someone get clean a beer.
I don't think that's
two.
It's worth three.
Three beers.
Love the delegation.
When you said that. When you said you have a captain service, yeah, there's a product up available at the market, like MoneyStop, where you can have a client relationship. Like, when you want a client to get engaged, have a client portal for where you can check psychological behaviors of the client. So from a fintech perspective, when you talk about Silicon Valley, how do you get a client engaged when you have security concerns or from a perspective where you want to see, like, from a financial planning perspective, how can you make change your client's life? How can you do that when you have a product available in the market, when you have cash flow surplus available for the client, and then you can make financial planning practice get to the next level? How is it possible,
So there's a question around in getting a client to be okay with security and stuff around the services.
Security as well as psychological behaviors, changing more about psychological behaviors of the client. When you know that information is available to the client, when you can see that online.
Yeah, so I think the concern with clients have around putting their internet banking login details into a product like MoneyStop is very real. And it's going to take a long time before that becomes mass. I actually don't think it's going to be until the banks do open APIs that this becomes a normal thing. We will get there in the next 5 years, hopefully. Maybe not five, but hopefully 10. So that will become mainstream, and that will become a lot easier. In the meantime, that's just all soft skills. That's just all how you communicate to a client. There's no way around that, unfortunately. Yeah.
I think what we might not be doing first is inspiring them enough to give a shit. So I think we get so excited about the numbers in the spreadsheet, we don't remember that lots of people will give over passwords for everything if they really want the thing they're giving over the password for. So if we can inspire them first, I think that's what we want.
No, but like we need to give them permission.
Last question, I think.
This is my first, so thanks. Interesting panel. I'm a startup and I'm making a financial synthetic that's on the blockchain. So I hope that eventually your advisors and this kind of collective could advise at one point in the future to advise that a blockchain type of asset class is an interesting thing for people to consider. So I'm wondering about blockchains. Each panel member, Peter, Nathan, and Joel would have an opinion about this. It's coming, it's here. I told John Price 3 years ago that it was coming. The question is regulatory burden and the friction that it causes. And I'm doing an ICO for a company called Solero.io. We make a recession-proof asset class, solar energy, a token. So I would like to see millennials be able to own a token, to then have that in a portfolio orchestrated by a mobile app, maybe recommended by a robo or more intelligent AI advisor. So I see a future, we're trying to build that future, and we're doing an ICO because there is no liquidity after seed funding here in Australia.
So I'm
the question is to compare and contrast. What's your opinion on ICOs?
I think, so change is here and we all know that's the case and we can't keep up. I think you can't underrate the power of the cardigan-wearing banks in this country. And what I mean by that, and I don't mean that hatefully, what I mean is that their lag in terms of responding to change is so extreme, it's decades. So, and a lot of people here, and I was one, are licensed through those institutions. And so therefore, we might love whatever new idea you have, but if we can't get compliance, a bit like the tech issue, if we can't get compliance who are run by lawyers who work for banks to think it's okay, there isn't enough noise we could make in the world to make that possible. So unfortunately, with the environment the way it is, it's battling those institutions to make it such that advisors can make that accessible. There's absolutely other investors, more wholesale, that could play, but I think that's my take.
Yeah, so there's ICOs every week, multiple. There's no sort of vetting for that. So it would be utterly impossible for an advisor to recommend any new ICO. Potentially, one day you might be able to get away with Bitcoin, potentially. You know, for as much as your product sounds great, but for advice, probably years and well.
I think I challenge you on that.
Sure.
Next year. But yeah.
Sure.
All good?
Sure.
Lovely. Thank
Ladies
you very
and
much.
Gentlemen, can we please get a huge round of applause for our panelists, Lane and Daniel, Bill, Robbie, and Ben Hicks. We've got a special gift for Joel and everyone. If we could just get an even bigger round of applause for our awesome MC, Peter Diamond. I think it's a bit of a special case, and clearly he's been talking about his engagement and upcoming wedding all night, so we decided to give his bottle of champagne to his bride to be. Thank you, Tate. Everybody, we're here until what time, Clay?
8 o'clock.
So we're here until 8:30, and then we'll be, where are we, Clay? Opera bar. I'm going to say opera bar, for anyone that, you know, that needs a snack. So thanks everyone for coming. Enjoy yourself. There's still a bunch of food. Bar's open until hopefully 8:30, maybe 8. Thanks very much for coming, and